Well, let me invite you to take your Bibles and open to Psalm chapter 19. Very appreciative of Kevin Smith. His kind, gracious introduction. And I just want to begin by saying that I want you to know that I know, because I know that you know, that when we left Elizabethtown last November, nobody anticipated it would be me standing here to give this presidential address rather than him. And I also want to assure you that nobody is more disappointed by this turn of events than I am. It has been a joy to serve these past 5 months as your Kentucky Baptist Convention president. I'm grateful to God. I have an extreme, deep appreciation for Dr. Chitwood and his staff that he has assembled that serve us in our churches. And I just want to say thank you, Kentucky Baptists, for your hard work in the kingdom and in the gospel. And we have much to celebrate today as we gather for this family reunion of churches all across this commonwealth whom the Holy Spirit of God is working in lives, seeing people saved, seeing believers conform to the image of Christ, seeing the church built. It is a great, great day to be a Kentucky Baptist. And I believe in the providence of God, and I believe that in those times he does have me here today, and I believe I have a word. And the reason I can say that with confidence that I have a word from God is I have the word of God. And so I know this is a presidential address. I don't know much about what that is. I'm merely an expositor. So we're going to work through a passage of scripture that I believe has several applications that I want to share with us as Kentucky Baptists. You know, the theme of this conference is give hope. And that verse from Hebrews chapter 6 that talks about the anchor of hope. And I want to tell you, we need an anchor today. We live in a fractured civilization. We live among cultural chaos, anxiety on many people, and even some calling it a moral revolution. We must drop anchor. And we need to have an anchor that will hold. Because the one thing that we can't have is just being adrift. There are too many theological denominations, too many churches, too many pastors, too many lives that have been beaten and battered by the waves and the winds of culture and theological, just wrong steps theologically. We need to have an anchor. Psalm 19 is a navigational map. It is a well-marked anchor spot here in the Word of God. Now, just a word of warning. Late this summer, I preached through Psalm 19 in my church at Corinth. It took about 8 weeks to go through this verse, so about 5.5 hours of sermon, and you're going to get it here in about the next 26 minutes or so. But as we look at Psalm 19, Psalm 19 is really the psalmist David making one point, and that is this: God has spoken. God has spoken. And we need to anchor our lives and our churches and our convention where God has spoken. Because it is there that the anchor holds firm. It is there that the anchor holds strong. But it's not just that God has spoken, but God has given us a mandate that because he has spoken, we must speak. We are his ambassadors. We are his messengers. We are the ones that must speak, but we must make sure, Kentucky Baptist, that what we speak is what God has spoken. The reality is, people don't want to hear what God has said because they don't want there to be a God at all. This is nothing new. This goes all the way back to Genesis 3 when there was the issue of, has God really said? And then not only the doubting what God had said, but the denial of what God has said. God has not said, you shall surely die. And then you read the distortion of what God has said. Even Jesus in his ministry said, you have heard it said. But I say unto you, there are the traditions, the distortions of men about what God has said. But through the doubt, through the denial, through the distortion that may come, God has spoken and he's spoken clearly. And he's called on us to speak clearly as well. Psalm 19, David begins by talking about the fact that God has spoken through his creation. Theologians call this the general revelation of God. It is those things like creation that are available to all people at all times, everywhere, the lost and the saved, that declare that there is a God. Through things like conscience and history and creation, we know, all men know, so that we are without excuse, Paul says in Romans chapter 1, that there is a God, that what can be known about God is clearly seen. But the problem is not that God has not spoken. The problem is that even though God has spoken, people have suppressed the truth in unrighteousness. The problem is, like Peter talks about in 2 Peter 3, that people deliberately overlook this fact that God has created the world and that God will judge the world. In Psalm 19, as David begins talking about this general revelation of God, just by way of background, in verses 1 through 4, I want you to notice the emphasis that the psalmist gives on God's communication, on God's speech. Look with me there. In Psalm 19, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. Their measuring line, or some translations say, their voice goes out through all the earth and their words to the end of the world. David is talking about the fact that God has spoken. And he's spoken through creation. Every butterfly, every waterfall, every sandy beach, every snow-capped peak, every sunset, every starry night, every peal of thunder, every morning dew, every trout-filled stream speaks to the glory of God. Creation's God's theater in which he performs. It's God's classroom in which he holds classes. Did you notice there it says, day after day pours out speech and night to night reveals knowledge. God has classes that fit your schedule, daytime or nighttime, but classes available. And for the millennials among us, God does podcasts. He does Snapchat. The creation is God's Instagram account of all of the images of what God is for his glory. God has spoken. But when we come to verse 7, something changes. God moves from talking about David moves from talking about God's general revelation to speaking of God's special revelation. He begins talking about the word. He begins talking about the scripture, the law of God. In fact, he's going to give, and this is where we're going to spend the majority of our time in just a moment, giving six descriptors of God's special revelation. But there's something else that changes between verse 6 and verse 7. See, in verses 1 through 6, David has used the common name for God, the Hebrew El, in talking about how God speaks through creation, that we might know that there is God. But in verse 7, when he comes to talk about God's special revelation, he moves from the word El to the name Yahweh, the covenant name of God, the intimate name of God. David says that, you know what? You can know God from creation. You can know God in his general revelation. But if you want to know that God, if you want to know God intimately, if you want to know him personally, you must engage him in his word. And I would take that a step further and say you must engage him through the word incarnate, his son, Jesus Christ. God speaks through his word. In verses 7 through 9, he gives six things that God's word is and six things that God's word does. Now, let me just say, I think as Baptists, generally, we've done a good job talking about what the Bible is. We use a lot of words to describe what the Bible is. Talk about it being God's word. We use descriptors like the fact that it is inerrant and it is infallible and it is authoritative. Our churches across the Southern Baptist Convention and across the Kentucky Baptist Convention are generally known as a people who believe that the Bible is true. One of the four pegs of the tent that covers our identity as Kentucky Baptists is that we have a high view of Scripture. And I want to tell you, it is rightly so. It's rightly so. But I would say, as good a job as we do talking about what God's word is, can I just, in brotherly love, point out an area that I think we neglect sometimes? And that is this. It's not just we have to have a high view of what God's word is. We have to have a high view of what God's word does. God's word does something. Can I add another descriptor that we need to have at the forefront of our understanding of God's word? And that is this. God's word is sufficient. It is sufficient. Now, when we talk about sufficiency, that doesn't mean like I go to the gas station when my fuel tank's empty and I put in a quarter of a tank and I say, well, you know, that'll get me home. That's sufficient. I know I'll need more later and it won't get me far, but it'll get me home. It's sufficient. That's not what we mean when we say that God's word is sufficient. What we mean, what the Bible means when it talks about the sufficiency of Scripture is that God's word lacks nothing. There is no deficiency. There is no room for improvement. There is no room for addition. Scripture tells us everything we need for life and godliness, and it is applicable to every conceivable area of our life. God's word is sufficient. I've heard it said that in an inerrant Bible, without a sufficient Bible, is an irrelevant Bible. And I believe there's a lot of truth to that. God's word is sufficient. It does something. And Kentucky Baptists, I would urge us to anchor in the sufficiency of God's word. I believe one of the biggest threats to seeing the power of the word of God unleashed in our community and unleashed in our churches is Christians who think God's word needs our help. Our creativity, our relevance, our edginess, our facilities, our style, our programs, our catchy titles, our outlines, our stories, our traditions, our apologies. We want to try to do something to prop up the word of God. The word of God doesn't need propping up by you and I. It needs to prop us up. You see, the question of whether we truly believe God's word is what it says it is this: do I trust God's word enough to believe it will do what God's word says it will do? There are many people, many pastors, many youth pastors, worship pastors, children's pastors, women's ministry leaders, children's ministry leaders who claim to believe the Bible is true. But when you look at their ministries, when you look at their churches, when you look at what they're trusting in, they're trusting more in chariots and horses than they are in the power of the Lord. They're trusting more in their ingenuity than they are in the all-sufficient Scripture that God has given us that does what God says it will do. The word does the work. God's word doesn't need our help. We need its help. Because we need his help, and the Scripture points us to him. Now, perhaps somebody might say, well, Andrew, you talk a lot about the Bible today. Isn't there a danger of elevating the Scripture to a level that it doesn't belong to? Well, I would say this. Jesus had a pretty high view of Scripture. When people came to him, and they had conversation with him and they talked to him. What did Jesus do in his life and ministry? He continually pointed people back to the word of God. Why? Because Jesus believed that the word was sufficient, that the word did the work. Well, what does David say in this passage? As I said, he tells us six things that God's word does, and six things that God's word is, and six things that God's word does. Let's look at them together. Beginning in verse 7. David says this, the law of the Lord is perfect, or it's blameless, reviving the soul. God's word is perfect. The word here he uses for the law is the word Torah. It has to do with the instruction of law. It doesn't just have to do with the Pentateuch, or doesn't just have to do with the Ten Commandments. It has to do with all of God's instruction, all of what we might say is doctrine. I think another way to summarize that is the scriptures. God's law is perfect. But you know what? I'm not. I'm fallen. I'm broken. I'm sinful. I'm rebellious against the King of heaven. How do I know that? Because I learned it from God's word. God's word is a mirror that shows us who we really are. It's a hammer that breaks us. God's word it indicts our life to show us we cannot please God on our own. We need a Savior, and then goes on to tell us that the Savior we need is outside of our own. We have to look to somebody else, and then God, the rest of the story, the fulfillment of the law is Jesus Christ came to fulfill all righteousness on our behalf. He did what we could not do. Well, how do we know we couldn't do it? Because the law of the Lord is perfect. And through Jesus' perfect fulfillment of the law of God, we not only have forgiveness of our sins, but we have the righteousness of Christ imputed to us. That's good news. That's gospel truth. The law of the Lord is perfect. It revives the soul. Hebrew word there is meshabah. It has to do with restoring, with refreshing. It's from the root shub, which means to repent. You see, God's word is what God uses to turn our life around to what it is intended to be. It is what leads us to repentance. John 10, Jesus said, thief comes, steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come that you might have life and have it abundantly. Have it. I think another way that Jesus said is to have a revived life. Only God's word can do this, and only God's word will do this. One of the phrases I've heard, frankly, my whole life, but a lot recently, is we really need revival. I agree. And you know what? We try a lot of tips and techniques and programs and all different plans to bring revival. But did you know what David says? David says, you want a surefire revival plan? The law of the Lord is perfect. It revives the soul. You want revival in your life? Spend time in the Word of God with the God of the Word. Your church need revival? Give them the Word of God. Sing the Word of God. Pray the Word of God. Do your discipleship from the Word of God. Teach your children to know the Word of God. Get before your students and your youth and teach them the Word of God. That's what God uses to bring revival to individuals' lives and what he uses to bring revival to his church. It's no secret. The Word, the law of the Lord is perfect. It revives the soul. It's what it does. The second thing he says is there at the second part of verse 7, he tells us another thing that God's word is. He says, the testimony of the Lord is sure. That means it's solid. It's unfailing. What God has given his account of what life is and what earth is and what heaven is and what his plan is, it is unfailing. It is solid rock. Brothers and sisters, that sounds like a good place that we need to anchor there. The testimony of the Lord is sure, that's what it is. But he tells us again what it does. It making wise the simple. You want to be wise? What do you need to do? You need to trust and know the testimony of the Lord. It makes wise the simple. You know, we're not born wise. In fact, the Bible describes lostness as our foolish hearts are darkened. We need wisdom. We need wisdom from God. We need to know the truth about who he is and who we are and therefore how we can relate to him, as we've already talked about. through Jesus Christ, wisdom incarnate. We're not saved wise. We come to Christ, we come trusting Him, we come with the faith of a child. But you know what? There's a lot of things about God and who He is and how He wants us to live that we don't know. That's why salvation is not the finish line in the Christian life, it's the starting blocks. Because we have to go forward in discipleship. So how do we make disciples? How do we make wise the simple? How do we grow people in Christ? We do it through the Word of God. The Word does the work. It does something. It is sufficient for that. James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. You know what happens when we ask God something? God answers. And you know how God answers in giving wisdom? It's kind of like Jeopardy. He gives the answers first. We just got to find the right questions. He's answered everything we need to know for life and godliness. James 3 and verse 13, James talks about how we live in wisdom. And he says this, James 3:13, who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. So how do we know who's wise? Well, we look at their lives. Brothers and sisters, the world should be able to look at us and see that we're walking in wisdom. How do we get that way? By going to the Word of God and then living out the Word of God in this world. Our behavior backs up our beliefs, and our actions speak. In verse 8, he gives us the third thing that God's word is. He says, the precepts of the Lord are right. The word precepts here means statutes. It means mandates. It means the decrees of the Lord. They are right. That means they're morally correct. They're just. It has to do with being straight as opposed to being crooked, to being true. Somebody says, well, you know, Andrew, there's just some things in the Bible I don't like. Well, you may not like them, but God does. And his ways are true. As for the Lord, his way is perfect. Again, I think one of the problems we have facing the world and facing the church today are professing Christians who aren't quite sure that God's precepts are right. Well, maybe they used to be right. Or maybe in some cultures they're right. Or maybe some things in there are right. Listen, as for the law of the Lord, the precepts of the Lord are right. We don't stand in judgment of how God should speak or what God should say. We don't hold God to our standards. He holds us to his. And he's spoken. And if we're going to anchor in such a way that we're going to hold firm in a day when wind and waves come crashing against us, we are going to have to anchor in the fact and in the truth that God's precepts are right. And it's not based on popularity. It's not based on opinion poll. It's not based on personal feeling. It's based on the truth of who God is. Precepts of the Lord are right. Well, what does it do? The third thing that God's word does is it rejoices the heart. The precepts of the Lord are right. Here's the irony. I think if we were to go to people and we were to ask them about this and say, here's the precepts that God has laid out, and these are right and these are true, people would say, well, that's no fun. I mean, God has all these rules and things, and how can, you know, that's not how I want to live. I want to do this and that and the other. The irony is this is how twisted our depraved minds are and how much we run to error rather than truth. The scripture tells us that the precepts of God are right, rejoicing the heart. Anybody here need joy? Any churches across this commonwealth? Need believers that are filled with joy? It's not happiness It's not just whatever our circumstances are, whatever happens to us. It's joy. There's a fount of joy in Christ that springs up in us. And we know this fount of joy as we walk with him, as we learn from him. The precepts of the Lord are right. They rejoice the heart. That's why if you're here today and you say, you know what, I've lost joy. Well, you know what God's word says? It gives a prayer of David when David had lost his joy because of his sin against God. And he said, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Anybody here need restored joy today? Why don't you call out to God like David in repentance, in brokenness, and say, God, I've lost my joy, but God, I know that only in you can I find it. And Lord, I believe that your precepts are right. I believe that's where joy for the heart is found. And today I want to come back to you, back to your word, to stand on your precepts, to believe what you've said, because it rejoices the heart. Paul says in Philippians, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Now listen, pastors, listen, Christians, we know there are some days where we may not feel like rejoicing. There are some dark valleys, even of the shadow of death, that we have to walk through, and we have to lead people through, and we have to, they're just part of life. But even in those moments, we can have joy. Where do we find that joy? It's not based on what we see around us. It's based on a true conviction, on an anchor point that God has spoken, that his word is true. And that here's the beautiful thing, that when we believe that God's word does what it does, when we go to his word, we anticipate and we expect that he is going to bring joy to our heart. And then our joy is doubled when he does exactly what he said he would do. He's twice faithful. Number four, the commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The commandments of the Lord are pure. That means they're holy. That means they're clean. That's what God's word is. It's pure because God who spoke it is pure. He is holy, and he's not just holy, he's holy, holy, holy. We can't even begin to express his holiness. And he comes and he says, the commandments are pure. They enlighten the eyes. Paul talks about this in the letter to the Ephesians in chapter 1 and verse 18. He says that we can have the eyes of your hearts enlightened that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. See, we need light on our path. We don't know what tomorrow holds. But God does. He's already been there. He's already seen it, and he will see you through. The word of God enlightens the eyes. But he goes on there in verse 9, the beginning, he says, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The fear of the Lord is clean. That's what God's word is. Is it possible that part of the reason why we're not seeing more people come to faith in Christ, more disciples made, more people living out their convictions and obedience, is it possible that the reason we're not seeing the Spirit of God fall with more power in our worship services is simply that we've lost the fear of God? You know, it's not that people aren't afraid. People are afraid of all sorts of things. Have you talked to them? Have you read their Facebook posts? People are afraid. Well, in Exodus chapter 20, God has just given Moses and his people the Ten Commandments. And in Exodus chapter 20, in verse 18, this is the conversation that takes place. It says, now, when all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and they trembled and they stood far off and said to Moses, you speak to us and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us lest we die. Now, pastors, let me just say parenthetically, I think there may still be people like this. Part of the problem is they don't mind hearing what you and I have to say, but they don't want to hear what God has to say. Well, listen, what you and I have to say doesn't matter. What God has to say is what's important. So let's give them the word of God. But they said, you speak to us and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us lest we die. Moses said to them, verse 20 of Exodus 20, do not fear. Do not fear, for God has come to test you that the fear of him may be before you, that you may not sin. So Moses says, don't fear, but fear God. Don't fear, but fear God. Oswald Chambers said it this way. He said, when we fear God, we fear nothing else. But if we do not fear God, we fear everything else. I think people have big fears because we've given them a small God. The fear of God endures forever. Church leaders, Sunday school teachers, choir directors, let us give people something eternal. You know, as we sit here today, there's only two things that are on this earth that last forever. The Word of God and the souls of men. The Word of God and the souls of men, those are the only thing that last forever. So brothers and sisters in Kentucky Baptist, why don't we invest ourselves in things that are gonna last? Why don't we invest in the eternal? The end of verse 9 gives us the sixth and final thing that David says that God's word is. He says, the rules of the Lord are true. And what it does, the righteous altogether. The rules of the Lord are true. Now, often when we think about rules, we think about going to the pool and all, you know, they have all the things there beside the pool. If you can't run and you can't jump and don't jump in and, you know, don't do anything. It's all the things my kids say. That's the only reason we go to the pools, to do all those things. You're telling us we can't. But this isn't those type of rules. This is, and we should be able to understand this because we had the Olympics this summer. You know, in the Olympics, they have judges who make rulings about the performances of the athletes. For example, in gymnastics or diving or some of the other sports, they will have a panel of judges. And what are the judges there for? They're there because the judges know the standard. And they know, well, if you do this many twists and this many turns and this many flips, that this is the level of difficulty. And the judges have in their mind an idea and an ideal how that should look if it's executed perfectly. And then the athletes execute their performance. And the judges judge them and make rulings on them about how their execution measured up to the ideal standard. Well, here, when it talks about the fact that the rules of the Lord are true, it's talking about, some translations say, the judgments of the Lord, the rulings of the Lord. God knows how life's supposed to work. He knows how life's supposed to look. He knows how the Christian life is supposed to look. And we know that we never measure up to it, but just like an Olympic athlete would say, well, you know what, I could never do the perfect dive. I could never do the perfect floor exercise. It's not even worth trying. I'll never get it right. No, what do? They keep disciplining themselves. They keep working. They keep trying. Why? Because they want to get as close to the ideal, the standard as possible. I would tell you that if athletes want to do that for their sport, why in the world would we as believers of Jesus Christ not want to do that in our walk with him? God has given us the standard. He has told us, and his judgments, his rules are true. They are righteous altogether. God will lead you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He's given us the righteousness of Christ. And even as we're told, you know, if God would not spare his own son, will he not give you all the more all of these things? I want to tell you that when you turn to God's word, when we anchor in God's word, it will never lead us astray and it will never lead us adrift. It will anchor us. So what do we do? I wish we had time to look at verses 10 and 11 about how valuable God's word is and the reward that's there. But the question I want us to think out as we close today's Kentucky Baptist is this. Okay, so we talked about what God's word is and we want to believe and put into action what God's word does and the sufficiency of scripture. But what about me? How do I get there? What do I need to do in my life if I'm gonna anchor with an anchor of hope? Well, God's word is sufficient. David tells us exactly what we need to do. Look at verse 14. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Let the words of my mouth, how are the words of my mouth going to be acceptable in God's sight? When words of my mouth match the words of his mouth. When we speak what God has spoken, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, out of the overflow of the heart, what happens? The mouth speaks. You want God's word to come out of your mouth? It's got to start because God's word is in your heart. We must speak what God has spoken. Brothers and sisters, Kentucky Baptist, waves of uncertainty will continue to come. A tsunami of cultural opinion will beat against our churches, and it will beat against the word of God. The winds of doctrinal compromise will blow. But the church, the convention, the family, the life that is anchored in the rock will stand. God has spoken. And we must speak what God has spoken. That is an anchor of hope. Let us anchor well with trust in the sufficiency of the word of God. Because of the sufficiency and the supremacy of Christ in God and of the word, he is our Redeemer. Let us proclaim Christ until he comes, that he has sought me and he has bought me with his redeeming blood. He is our Redeemer and he is our rock. Let us anchor there.